Welcome everyone, my name is Pramod Beesal and in this video we are going to discuss about the hydraulic and pneumatic actuators. Okay, mostly they are common in construction with each other. The only difference is basically the driving factor, which is in case of hydraulics we are going to have pressurized oil, and in case of pneumatic we have compressed air. Okay, so that is the basic difference. Another difference comes in terms of the pressure, so that we are going to discuss subsequently. Okay, so what is an actuator? The actuator is an output device which convert energy from pressurized hydraulic oil in case of a hydraulic actuator or compressed air in case of a pneumatic actuator into required type of action or motion. Okay, so whatever action that we want to have, or the whatever type of conversion into mechanical energy that we want to have from a actuator, we can have that conversion here. Okay, so they are basically used in gripping. Okay, so either we want to grip something or in moving type of operations. Okay, so we want to either grip something or we want to move something from one place to another place. Now based upon that movement basically, okay, or based upon other applications, we can classify the actuators into certain categories. Okay, so the classification can be, number one, it could be a linear actuator. Okay, so when I say linear actuator, we mean that the conversion of the energy will be into linear motion. Okay, so we are going to get a linear motion as our output. Second conversion, it can be classified as a rotary actuator also. Okay, and in case of a rotary actuator, the output is going to be rotary motion. Okay, output will be rotary motion. Okay, basically there can be a third classification also, which is basically not related with the motion, and that can be actuators to operate the flow control valves. Okay, so we can use them to operate the flow control valves also. Now in case of flow control valve operation, the basic use will be to control the flow of flow and pressure of the fluid. Okay, so here to control flow and pressure of the fluid, of whatever fluid onto which we are having the operation, we can control its pressure as well as its direction of the flow. Okay, so that is the main applications of a actuator, and that is the main classification basically. Now when we say the pressure range, or a hydraulic actuator is basically used for a pressure range of roughly 100 bars. Okay, 100 bar are given by hydraulic actuator. Okay, but if we are limiting our operations to 10 bar mostly, then a 10 bar can be attained with the help of a pneumatic actuator also. Okay, so that is the basic difference between the application of a hydraulic or a pneumatic actuator. Rest, the construction wise or the application wise, they are both similar only. Okay, so now let's do their classification based upon their construction also. Okay, so based upon the construction also, we can divide these hydraulic actuators or the pneumatic actuators into certain categories. So let's say the first category of hydraulic cylinders is single acting cylinder. Okay, so we are having a single acting cylinder, means the liquid or the fluid or the air will be entering from one side and it will be exerting pressure onto this particular piston. Say this is our piston. Okay, and because of that pressure that it is exerting onto the piston is going to move into forward direction, and this direction we call as extension stroke. Okay, this is nothing but a extension stroke, or the desired direction that we are having. Okay, now when it has moved to certain position, we want to, or we like to bring it back to the original position. Okay, so there is no particular mechanism to bring it back here basically. Okay, and there is one more thing, that we have air vent also. So we can have it open in this side, or we can have it closed. So when we have it as closed one, so there will be a air vent to vent out the air basically. Okay, if I look at the side view of this particular cylinder and the piston arrangement, okay, this is our piston, this is my rod. Okay, and this is my cylinder, this is the input port or the inlet port. Okay, and this is the vent. Basically we are having a vent to let out or in the air. So the side view will look like something like this. So this is our piston, okay, circular in nature, and onto this we are having our rod also. So that is our rod part basically. Fine. So this is my piston and this is my rod, and I can have these two dimensions over here. The dimension, this overall dimension is the diameter of the piston. We can represent it with the help of dp, and this smaller dimension is diameter of the rod. We can represent it with the help of a dr. Okay, now as I told you that we are not having any retracting motion here, or the return motion is not being done with the help of fluid or the air, so we can have separate mechanism to get the return stroke here. Okay, so depending upon the position, we either can have a horizontal cylinder, okay, or we can have a vertical cylinder also. Okay, so usually in our horizontal cylinders we have a spring based return mechanism. Okay, so this is my cylinder. Okay, so this was the cylinder that we had here. Fine. And onto this cylinder, when I am applying my piston over here, this is the vent and this is the rod. Okay, or whatever I want to move in forward direction or the reverse direction. Now I will be applying a spring over here. Okay, so there can be a spring controlled return motion. Okay, a spring return motion. So basically what will happen, whenever the fluid is pushing this piston into this direction, whenever the fluid pressure is enough, it will compress the spring and move into this direction. After that, when I want it to get returned to the initial position, we will let the liquid out of here, okay, by opening the valve, and it will simply return with the help of spring energy that was stored into it while the compression. Okay, so there can be a horizontal based or a spring controlled one. There can be another condition here. We can have a external weight control, or we can say gravity controlled return also. Okay, so gravity controlled return. Now in case of a gravity controlled return, what will happen, we usually have, so we can have it for vertical cylinders only. Okay, so let's say this is my vertical cylinder. Fine. This is my inlet port, or this is my piston. Fine. And this is my rod. Okay, now onto this particular rod I will put some external weight here. Okay. W. So whenever I'm pushing it, or when I'm pushing it upward, I will simply supply the fluid from here and it will push the rod and the piston upside, and whenever I want it to get down, I will simply open the valve so that fluid can return there, and by virtue of this potential energy stored in this particular weight, it will return to its original position. Okay, so that is the mechanism for a gravity control tool. Okay, so now we are going to discuss about a double acting cylinder. Now what will happen in a double acting cylinder, that the extension stroke means the moving out of the piston, as well as the retraction stroke or the return stroke means coming back of the piston, both are being governed by fluid only. Okay, so let's say this is my port A and this is my port B. So whenever the fluid enters from here, let's say with a flow rate of Q1. Okay, so whenever it is entering here with the flow rate of Q1, it is going to push the piston into external direction, or the extension stroke. Okay, so we are going to get a extension stroke here. Okay, so then in that case, what will happen, if the fluid is already present here in our second chamber, it will get moved out. Okay, because the piston is moving in this direction, so it will move this fluid out of the port here. Okay, now what will happen after the extension stroke has been achieved, in order to get our retraction stroke or the return stroke, what will happen, the fluid will come from here with a let's say flow velocity or a flow rate of Q2, and that will push the piston from this side. Now this particular flow will get out of this particular port. Okay, so port A and port B are basically used to control the liquid flow rate between the corresponding chambers, and both ports are governed for basically the extension stroke as well as the retraction stroke. And if I look at the side view of this particular system here, so this is my piston, okay, and this is my rod. So the diameter of the piston is, let's say, dp. Okay, and similarly the dimension of this our rod is dr. Okay, so this dimension is dr we are having over here, and this dimension we are having here is dp. Now in the both the cases, means if I consider the case of extension, What will happen in case of extension? If Q1 is the flow rate, then with respect to that Q1, my velocity or the velocity of extension of the piston is going to be equal to what? Flow rate divided by area. Okay, and area will be how much? Area of the piston, whole piston will be there, because it is acting on this whole piston here. So it will become Q divided by pi by 4 dp square here. Okay, at the same time, the force will be how much? Pressure, whatever is the pressure that is there. So let's say P1 into area, or area is again AP only. So that will become the force. If I talk about the power, then power can be given by force into velocity. Okay, and force is P1 into AP, and velocity is Q1 upon AP. So that will come out to be P1 into Q1. Okay, so that will be the power that I need to supply to move the piston. Okay, now if I talk about the return stroke or the retraction stroke, what will happen in our retraction stroke? Let's say I am supplying the fluid with a flow rate of Q2. Okay, now with respect to that flow rate Q2, my velocity of the piston in our return stroke will be equal to how much? V2 will be, now this liquid force will be acting onto this area only. Means now return stroke, this particular area will be the one on which my force will be acting. Means the area here, that is Q2 divided by AP minus AR, where AR is the area of rod. So I can say it is equal to Q2 upon pi by 4 dp square, the piston diameter square, minus dr square, that is the rod diameter square. Okay, similarly, if I calculate the other parameters here, then the force exerted on the piston will be equal to P2 into P minus AR, because that is the only area on which the load will, the force, the pressure will be acting. At the same time, I can say that power will be equal to, power in our return stroke will be equal to force into velocity, right? Force into velocity, and that will again come out to be P2 into Q2. Okay, so that is how we can compare these two with each other, the extension stroke as well as the retraction stroke. But the only thing is here, if my Q1 is equal to Q2, then automatically my velocity 1 will not be equal to velocity 2. Okay, and that may create certain problem in our operations or in our control system, because we will need to then design the system as per the difference in velocity. Okay, so what do we have here is, we have a separate system under this category only, and we call that as double acting. So we are still having a double acting cylinder only, double acting, double rod cylinder. Okay, so the rod will basically be extended onto both the sides. Okay, so what will happen here, that this is my cylinder, the main cylinder. Okay, this is my piston. Fine. And the rod has been extended onto both of the side for the operations. Now the area on both of these sides, means on the extension stroke as well as on the retraction stroke, is going to be same only. Okay, in both the cases the area will be AP minus AR, and we will be getting same parameters on extension stroke as well as our retraction stroke. Okay, so that is the solution that we can adopt for the same area and same parameters to get in both strokes. Fine. Now, until and unless it is mentioned in our exam that we are having a double rod side, double side rod, we are not going to take it as a double side. We will only consider this configuration. Okay, so this is the standard configuration. Unless and otherwise it is mentioned, we are not going to change it. Okay, and always in extension we will consider the area of the piston, and in our retraction stroke we will consider the area AP minus AR. Okay, so that is the general configuration of any the hydraulic actuator. Hydraulic actuator cylinder, basically in the two configurations that we have discussed here, double acting and single acting. Now what will happen, there will be one more problem regarding this operation of the hydraulic cylinders here, and that is the problem of this sudden jerk that the piston will feel when it is hitting the end cap. Okay, so let's say this is my piston and it is moving in this direction, so obviously I will be providing certain and stoppers here. Okay, some stoppers, so that this piston, when it is moving in this direction, it will come up till this point and it will stop, right? So there is going to be certain end cap or certain stoppers which will stop the piston here, right? So which will stop the motion of piston, that it has reached to the desired position and we need to stop it. Now, because of that end cap or the stoppers that we are using here, there is going to be certain amount of noise. Okay, so it will create certain noise onto the piston or in our system, and it will create certain vibrations also. Okay, so there is going to be generation of vibrations and there is going to be generation of noise that will deteriorate the health of our system, the health of our hydraulic system overall, and the cylinder and the piston is going to get deteriorated because of these conditions. So in order to avoid them, in order to avoid the shock, the noise and the vibrations, what we do, we use cushioning here. Okay, so we use something called as cushioning. In cushioning, what we will do, so I will simply put a cushion onto this piston part over here. Okay, so I will put this cushion so that whenever it is going to hit the end cap or the end stoppers, first the cushion will come into contact and that will damp away the vibrations slowly, and it will damp away the noise or the shock slowly. Okay, so for that matter we use the cushion here. When I am doing the cushioning of our hydraulic actuator, there can still be two type of situations here. So basic reason or the basic aim of this cushioning is to damp out the vibration or to damp out the noise. Okay, so there can be two cases here, that there can be an over damping in our system, okay, and there can be an under damping in our system. Okay, so both these things are possible here. Okay, so over damping means the factor or the force is getting damped very fast. The damping is too fast and we need to slow down that damping. Now, in order to slow down the damping, the kinetic energy of our piston, that was half mv square. So what is happening in damping, that it is absorbing this kinetic energy basically, because it is bringing this kinetic energy from v velocity to zero, right? So over damping, in order to overcome the over damping, we need to increase the kinetic energy. Okay, so in order to overcome the over damping, okay, we don't want over damping in our system. So what we can do, we can increase the kinetic energy, and that kinetic energy increase can be achieved with the help of increase in velocity. Okay, increase in velocity. Now the velocity increment can be attained with the help of external factors like controlling our valve opening, controlling the volume flow rate, and all these things we can control the velocity. Second, I can increase the mass also. Okay, increase the moving mass basically. Okay, so the mass of piston and the mass of the rod can be increased, but that is not a desirable input to overcome the damping here. The third option that we can use here is to decrease the operating pressure. Okay, so we can decrease the operating pressure in this case. Now all these actions can be taken to overcome the over damping. Now in case we are having under damping means that we have taken all these adjustments. Okay, so despite adjustments there is a shock. Okay, so there is still a shock that we are feeling despite our adjustments. Over damping is despite all alignments. Okay, everything is perfectly aligned and all, and still despite all alignments we feel shock. Okay, I can say shock or they have been over damped or they have been damped very fast. Okay, now when I have done all the adjustments and if I am still feeling a shock, then means it is a condition of under damping, and the condition of under damping can be overcome. Okay, so to overcome under damping, if I want to reduce the under damping in my system, then I can take measures which will be directly opposite to these ones. Okay, so I can reduce the velocity, the very first. Second, I can reduce the moving mass. Okay, or third, I can increase the operating pressure over here. Okay, so these conditions will save or will bring my system, basically they will save my system from under damping here. Okay, if all these things do not work here, then I can additionally use external dampers also. Okay, so external dampers can also be used here to support the damping action. Fine. Now that is the basic theory of a single acting cylinder and a double acting cylinder hydraulic these actuators. Now let's take a look at the previous year questions from this particular part of the actuators. Okay, And when we look at it, the previous year questions, the first question that was asked in year 2017, that what will be the velocity of piston movement for a single acting hydraulic actuator when fluid pressure is 100 bar. Okay. Now we all know that one bar is equal to 10 raised to power 5 Pascal or 100 kilopascals. Okay. That is the standard that we all follow, the conversion between a bar and a Pascal. So what will be the velocity of piston movement? We need to calculate the velocity. Hydraulic actuator, when the fluid pressure is given to me as 100 bars and the diameter of the piston is given as 50 mm, comma flow rate, the volume flow rate is given as 0.3 meter cube per minute. Okay, I need to calculate the velocity. So I know that velocity is equal to Q divided by area. Okay, so it will be 0.3 meter cube per minute, means 0.3 divided by 60.3 meter cube. Per second. So I will divide it by 60 and then it will be divided by pi by 4 into d square. D square means 50 square. So that will give me the final answer over here. Okay. So if I calculate this value, then it will come out to be 0.3 multiplied by 4 divided by 60 into pi into 50 into 50. Okay. So that will be, I think, 2.54 meter. Per second. Okay, so that is our answer over here. Now the next question that we have is from 2018 prelims, and in 2018 prelims it was asked that a force of 10 kilonewton is required to make a workpiece move. What is the needed working pressure if the piston die is 100 mm? Okay, so very straightforward question. We need to calculate the force when I am given this piston die as 100 mm. Okay, so the area will be pi by 4 into 0.1 square because I can convert it in meter. And into pressure will give me the force, and force needs to be 10,000 newton here. Okay, so I can calculate my pressure will be equal to, how much will that value be? So it will be nothing but 10,000. So 10,000 multiplied by 4 divided by 0.1. Okay, so it will come out to be 1.27 megapascal. Okay, you can calculate these things also on your own. The main thing is concept here. Okay, if a workpiece is moved by 50 mm, again in 2018 prelims question, if a workpiece is moved by 50 mm in 10 seconds by a piston of diameter 100 mm, the liquid flow rate is, so we need to calculate Q over here. We are already given that a piston is being moved by 50 mm in 10 seconds. Okay, so the speed or the velocity will be 50 mm divided by 10, that is 5 mm per second. Okay, and the piston diameter, means we can calculate the area over here, that is pi by 4 into 0.1 square. So I can calculate Q. Q is going to be pi by 4 into 100 square, let's keep that this in mm square only, into 5 mm per second, so that I can calculate the answer in mm cube per second here. Okay, so that will be nothing but 100 10 raised to power 4, that will come, so 3.14 divided by 4 into 5, so it is nothing but 3.925 into 10 raised to power 4 mm cube per second. Now depending upon the unit that are given in our options, we can calculate, we can choose the right or correct objective answer here. Okay, so these were the three questions from prelims. There were extra questions also in 2018. There was a question, but that was from diaphragm actuator, so we will discuss that in our next video. Also there was a question in 2017 mains regarding the properties of hydraulic actuator, that also we will discuss in detail in next video. Okay, now let's have a look at some practice questions here. Okay, so there is a pump that supplies oil at 0.02 meter cube per second. So we are given Q as 0.002 meter cube per second. First of all, to a 50 mm dia, double acting cylinder and rod dia is 20 mm. Okay, so diameter of the piston or that of cylinder is 50 mm and diameter of the rod is 20 mm, that is given to us. Okay, if external load is assumed to be 6000 newton, okay, so the load or the force that can be assumed is 6000 newton in both extension as well as retraction strokes. Now I found out the piston velocity, applied pressure, and power transmitted in both of these strokes. Okay, so let's first talk about the extension stroke. In our extension stroke, we need to calculate the piston velocity first, right? So piston velocity V can be given with the help of Q divided by AP, and that will be 0.002 divided by pi by 4 into D square, and D square means 50 mm square. So it is in mm, we can convert in meter for our use here. Okay, so that will come out to be, I think, 1.018 meter per second. Okay, similarly I can calculate the pressure here, and the pressure will be given by force divided by AP again. Okay, and force is 6000 newton, so pressure when I calculate here, that will be 3.05 megapascals. Okay, and when I calculate the power transmitted, so power can be calculated either by force into velocity or by Q into pressure, and both these things will give me the same result only, and that is going to be the power value is 6.11 kilowatt over here. Okay, if I talk about the retraction stroke, then again if I calculate the velocity, then it will be Q divided by AP minus AR. That is important here for the retraction stroke. So that will be Q, that is 0.002 divided by pi by 4, and 50 square minus 20 square, and then we need to convert it into meter, right? So the velocity here, that will come out to be 1.212. So obviously it will be higher because the area has reduced here. Okay, and if I calculate the pressure, then again it will be F upon AP minus AR value only. So pressure value will come out to be here, I think, 3.65 megapascal. So it has also again increased because the overall area is reducing here, onto which the force is being applied. So it, and then finally if I calculate the power value here, then power, that is F2 into V2 or Q2 into P2, that will come out to be 7.3 kilowatt. Okay, now let's have this another question, and that says a hydraulic cylinder has to move a table of 13 kilonewton. Okay, so for example, there will be some hydraulic cylinder here, and this hydraulic cylinder is connected to a table or a mass which is of 13 kilonewton. Okay, this 13 kilonewton mass has to be moved with the help of our hydraulic actuator. Now by accelerating its speed up to 0.13 meter per second in 0.5 second. Okay, so it is accelerating from 0 meter per second to 0.13 meter per second in 0.5 seconds. Okay, the assuming the coefficient of sliding friction, so the sliding friction between the surface and the table is assumed to be as 0.15, and the cylinder diameter, that is our DP, is 50 mm. Okay, so we need to calculate the pressure here that needs to be applied onto this side so that we can achieve this particular motion. Okay, so if you look at the overall phenomena here, what is happening, that this rod is being applied by a pressure from this side. Okay, and when it is moving this particular table into this direction, there will be the friction force onto this, the legs of this particular table in opposite direction. That is going to be my friction force over here. Okay, mu into F normal, and F normal is nothing but the weight, or mg. Okay, so there is going to be a frictional force of mu mg acting in this direction, right? And the pressure is applied in this direction. So overall, I need to have an acceleration in this direction, right? The acceleration of mass should be in this direction. Okay, so by applying our acceleration concept here, the concept from mechanics, simply the net force in the direction of acceleration, that will give me ma. Okay, so net force in direction of acceleration is pressure into area that is being applied here minus this force, that is mu into mg, and that will be equal to m into a. Okay, now we need to calculate the mass here. So mass can be calculated with the help of total weight, that is 13,000 newton divided by g, right? And that will be 13,000 divided by 9.81 kg. So that is our mass, and I can use that value here. Okay, I need to calculate the pressure, so I can say that P into AP is equal to nothing but MA. So MA is 13,000 divided by 9.81 into acceleration. What will be the acceleration? The delta V divided by delta T. So acceleration is 0.13 divided by 0.5, right? V2 minus V1 divided by T2 minus T1. You can call it anything. So we can calculate the acceleration over here, MA plus mu mg. Okay, this will go here and it will become plus. So plus is 0.15 into mg. Mg is nothing but 13,000 newton over here. Okay, so we can calculate the values here. Fine. and this will give me PAP. Now, if I can need to calculate the pressure only, then this whole value that will come out to be, I think it will be, how much it will be? 2.294 it will be. 2.294 kilonewton. Okay. That value divided by the area, and area is pi by 4 AP. Pi by 4 DP square. Okay. And now I put the values here. So pressure value will be 2294 in, because it is in kilonewton, divided by pi by 4 into DP. DP is how much? 50 mm, right? I will keep it in mm so that I can calculate the final value in megapascal. So that will come out to be, I think, 1.168 megapascal. Okay, so that is our final result over here. Okay, now let's discuss this last question here. A cylinder with diameter of 80 mm. Okay, so we are given first as our DP of 80 mm, the diameter of our piston or the diameter of the cylinder. Rod diameter, the DR, is given as 45 mm here. It drives a load of 7000 newton. So the W value here is 7000 newton, or I can say that mass value will be equal to 7000 divided by 9.81 kgs over here. Okay, then the next information that is given to me, that there is a flat surface and coefficient of friction between this surface and the load, that mu is 0.12 over here, and the load is decelerated within a cushion length of 20 mm. Okay, so the length or S value is 20 mm and we are decelerating our load. Okay, so when it is being pushed by the pressure from this side, okay, so it is moving in this direction, right? It is moving in this direction. So we are limiting our cushion length as 20 mm, that it will come in stop, or it will come to rest in 20 mm of the length. If the input pressure is 50 bar, compute the fluid pressure developed in the cushioning. Okay, we need to calculate the fluid pressure that has been developed. In cushioning, what is the force and the fluid pressure that has been developed? Okay, so the very first thing that we need to calculate here is acceleration. So what all forces are acting here? If we talk about the forces here, then first of all, since it is moving in this direction, so there is an acceleration force. Okay, so there is MA over here in the direction of motion. Right, then since the direction of motion is like this, there will be the friction force here, and that will be mu mg, or the mu w load. Okay, nothing but mu w. Then there is P into A acting in this direction, and to oppose this direction of motion, there is a cushioning force over here. Okay, so there is a cushioning force, I can say, or let's say FC, F cushioning. Okay, cushioning force. So finally, I can say that all the forces net sum in this direction, in the direction of acceleration, okay, that will be equal to MA only. So finally, I will put up the equation as PA, that is P into AP, minus my cushioning force minus mu mg. These are the net loads in this particular direction, and that will be equal to MA. Now I need to calculate the acceleration here. Okay, and for acceleration, I can again use the formula V square minus U square is equal to 2AS. Okay, so the final velocity that I need to reach is zero square, zero velocity, right? The initial velocity is given to me as 15 meter per minute. Okay, so that will be 15 meter per minute square. Okay, and that is equal to 2 into acceleration into S. How much distance? 20 mm distance is allowed for the cushioning over here. Okay, so overall, I can say here that my acceleration value will come out to be, that will be minus 1.56 meter per second square. Okay, so that will be my acceleration value. Now I will put all these values into my original equation. So what I need to calculate here is cushioning force, right? So cushioning force FC will be given by MA. Okay, so mass is, how much is my mass? That is given to me as 7000 newton divided by 9.81 into acceleration, and acceleration is minus 1.56. okay, MA. And okay, this will be, okay, let's take FC in this direction and MA in this direction, so it will become minus here because it is getting transferred here. So minus MA plus PAP. Okay, so plus P. P is how much? The pressure was given to me as 50 bar, right? So 50 into 10 raised to power 5, that is pressure into area, because it is acting on the piston area, plus this, and minus mu into mg. Okay, so mu is 0.12 into m is 7000, mg is 7000, right? So I can calculate the cushioning force over here. So this value will become positive overall, and these values, if I put, the cushioning force will come out to be cushioning force will be 25393.1 newton. Okay, so that is my cushion force. Okay, so I calculated the cushioning force here. I needed to calculate the cushioning pressure or the fluid pressure which is applying the cushioning here. So let's say there is some system here that I have applied and there is a fluid into it. Okay, and that fluid is basically applying the cushioning effect. Okay, I'm using a fluid to apply the cushioning effect. So the net pressure of the cushioning that would be felt by that particular fluid is going to be equal to whatever is the load of cushioning or the force of the cushioning divided by area, and area here now will be AP minus AR. Okay, so I can say this will be 25393.1 newton divided by pi by 4 of D square. Outer diameter was 80 mm minus 45 square, and that will give me P cushioning to be 7.39 megapascal. Okay, so that is the basic fundamental of cushioning force or the other forces and all these things. We are using the D'Alembert's principle here to apply the acceleration loops here. Okay, so that is easier for you to relate. Everywhere we have used the D'Alembert's principle. Okay, D'Alembert's principle. Fine, that is all about this video, and well, thank you for watching, and best of luck for your exam.